I got into this talk thanks to Linda Young, who somehow skillfully managed to flatter me into giving a talk on a subject about which I know relatively little. So what I suggested is that I could give a talk giving an overall perspective of science, where it stands now, and CP1's role in it. When I agreed, I did some homework, and I learned all sorts of things which I wasn't aware of, and I will try to give you a picture of it, together with a sort of an overview of evolution, humanity, science, CP1. So, how should we think of science? I like to think of it in terms of institutional form of an evolutionary trait that has served our species very well. We have curiosity, drive to explore, to understand, and to put to use the things that we learn about the way the world around us works. It's only in the last few hundred years that this skill became institutionalized in the form of science. A lot of things have been done. I don't want to give a complete history, and I'm unable to do that in the time given and otherwise. So I'll start in the relatively modern age, roughly the last 150 years. As I mentioned here, the Newton and a number of other people achieved a lot in our classical understanding of science. So let me start with the smallest things known at the time, how the chemical properties of elements behave. There were ideas about this from the very beginning. Democritus already had the idea of there must be atoms, invisible things that cannot divide it further without changing the properties. Aristotle somehow postulated that everything was made of four elements. It wasn't until the 18th century that Lavoisier started finding specific elements and named hydrogen, oxygen, silicon, sulfur, and so on. It was not so long ago, my grandfather was alive at the time, that Mendeleev found that if he plotted elements or listed elements in order of their weight, there were certain cycles that seemed to be repeating, including predicting some new ones. And then in the 20th century, Moseley, looking at characteristic X-rays, discovered that they followed a very strict relationship, the square root of the frequency of X-rays plotted as a function of this atomic number fell in a straight line, so that it was clear that charge, the number of electrons, determined the chemical properties, and further gaps were identified and later found. At about the turn of the century, a number of things happened that were qualitatively new. Thomson discovered electrons. Rutherford, the centennial was just a few years ago, demonstrated that atoms had a positively charged, very small nucleus. And just 2 years later, Bohr, working with Rutherford, at Rutherford's lab, explained how combining Planck's idea of a quantum could then be used to explain the crucial properties of atoms. New visions of the world came into being at almost in the same period, the first decade or so of the
just around the turn of the century. One was that the picture that was comfortably accepted as the picture of a world changed when Einstein realized the consequences of trying to unify what was known about the velocity of light with everything else, and came up with the theory of relativity, fundamentally recasting our perspective of the physical world in which we live. Einstein and relativity became icons for the coming age, up to the present. No other scientist is mentioned as much as Einstein. The other new vision of the world that qualitatively changed things from a Newtonian picture was quantum theory. It started with Planck and Einstein's idea of quantized radiation, Bohr, who showed how to apply this idea to atomic structure, and a whole host of people who developed quantum mechanics. It defined physics for the latter part of the 20th century and into the present. With new particles, electrons, and nuclei determined, people got busy measuring masses with the most conventional way of pushing charged particles, accelerating them, pushing them through electric and magnetic fields, and determining their charge to mass ratio. Thomson measured the electron and the electron charge from oil drop experiments. The mass of electron was known. Aston was the first who systematically explored the measurement of masses. And the thing that was somewhat puzzling in Mendeleev's work, that the masses did not increase smoothly for the periodic table, but the charges did, was clarified, because he discovered, for instance, here with neon, that there were several masses corresponding to what was accelerated neon particles. He discovered isotopes. In the same time frame, radioactivity was discovered, somewhat accidentally by Becquerel, but not really accidentally. He was following, exploring fluorescence and found some strange phenomena which he pursued. Curie followed shortly after and discovered other radioactive isotopes. This is a picture of the serendipitous discovery by Becquerel. This is an image of Curie's logbook, which got so contaminated in her work of refining uranium that it's still contained in the lead box. When the next 15, 20 years, mass measurements were refined, it was found that nuclear masses showed an interesting pattern. Plotted here is the binding energy. Remembering the result of relativity, that E equals mc squared, one can simply take the mass and determine how much less mass there is than the sum of the constituent masses. And you see that here there's a maximum binding in the vicinity of iron. Above that, the repulsive positive charges piled close together reduce the binding. This was recognized, and rather quickly, in 1934, it was discovered that nuclear energy was, in fact, the fuel of the sun and, by implication, the stars, in burning hydrogen into helium, just combining free protons into the zero binding deuterons on up to helium, huge energy gain. And it wasn't until 20 years later that Fowler and et al. Showed that further burning of nuclei in hotter and hotter stars produced elements to iron. Eventually, when all the lighter fuel is used up, the stars collapse. Supernova, a cataclysmic event in which the collapse takes place, and the heaviest elements are made again in nuclear reactions. The amount of energy in nuclear reactions is many times more than any chemical reactions can contain. And this was recognized early in the 1930s. H.G. Wells wrote science fiction novels about it, and so on. But Rutherford poo-pooed the idea, saying, yes, yes, this is true, it can happen in stars perhaps, but it's never going to be practical. Then, interesting comment on science is how neutrons were discovered. Isotopes were known, but the idea of a neutron was not accepted. It wasn't considered something you talked about unless it had been seen. The textbook by Rutherford, Chadwick and Ellis, that was published in 1930, talks about nuclei being made of protons, alpha particles, and electrons. No mention of neutrons. Yet the idea was there that conceivably there could be such a thing, and Chadwick finally discovered that there's rather penetrating radiation, and in 1932 announced the discovery of a neutron. That caused a great deal of excitement, because until then, nuclear reactions could not be could only be done with radioactive alpha particles and very low energy accelerators, producing just a few hundred kilovolt particles, so they're restricted to light nuclei. But now that there were neutral particles, such as neutrons, many nuclear reactions became possible. And one of the many people jumped on this, but the most systematic work was done by Fermi's group in Rome. And they discovered two critical things. One is that the interaction cross-sections, attenuation of neutrons by different species, different elements, varied a great deal from element to element. Some of them were many orders of magnitude larger than others. Fermi himself and others quickly understood this in terms of quantum theory. Neutrons had to have a wavelength. Low energy neutrons are moderated to low temperatures by scattering of whatever material they interacted with. And at low energies, they could have enormous cross sections depending on whether there happened to be an excitation of a nucleus near that low energy threshold. These Bright and Wigner were theorists who formulated this and called Bright-Wigner resonances. Neutrons also gave a possibility to look at induced radioactivity. And when Fermi's group found that they bombarded the heaviest known nucleus, uranium, with neutrons, they saw some radioactivities that they couldn't explain that had the chemistry different from uranium, and they assumed that they had made a new element. This is a paper in Nature by Fermi, published in 1934. And Fermi, in fact, received the Nobel Prize in 1938 for his demonstrations of the existence of new radioactive elements produced by neutron radiation, and for work with slow neutrons. The amazing thing is that 2 weeks later, a paper appeared in the German Journal of Naturwissenschaften saying that the new element was barium, a known element, a radioactivity associated with that. Hahn and Strassmann were chemists, very good chemists, and there was very little doubt in their mind that what they saw could be nothing other than barium. Well, by that time, Fermi was on a boat from Stockholm to New York. He'd taken a position at Columbia, not wanting to return to fascist Italy, and he didn't know anything about it. But Lise Meitner was an Austrian physicist who had lived in Berlin and worked together with Hahn for some 20 years. And they worked very closely on the same subjects. So she was very familiar with it. She was a physicist. Hahn was a chemist. Since
she was Jewish or Jewish background, by 1938, she was forced to leave Germany. She had been able to continue. This was the predecessor of the Max Planck Institute, the Kaiser Wilhelm Institute, and by 1938, Austria was annexed by Germany in the Anschluss, and she was forced to, she escaped through Holland and went to Sweden. Her nephew was Otto Frisch, who had also taken up physics and was doing the equivalent of a postdoc at the Niels Bohr Institute, what is now the Niels Bohr Institute in Copenhagen. Over the Christmas holidays, the Nobel Prize was awarded December 12th. The Hahn-Meitner article came out December 22nd. The nephew visited the aunt, and they went on vacation in Sweden, a walking tour, discussed this result. And in the course of that walk, they came up with the idea that it must be fission. It was, I think, Meitner who had the idea. And they published a paper in Nature on suggesting that what Hahn and Meitner had seen was fission. Hahn and Meitner say that we don't understand how the barium came here. It's a reaction that's never been seen before. We don't know how it happened. Hahn and Meitner came up with the explanation. There's a letter from Meitner that those of you who read German will appreciate. Hähnchen is a diminutive of Hahn. This is physics. You do not understand that at all. This, I think, says the diminutive use is a measure of a rather close relationship that they had. They were good friends, and she was just teasing him. Now, going back a few years, when the neutron came out, Leo Szilard, a Hungarian physicist who by then was in London, came up with the thought that if neutrons can produce nuclear reactions in which more neutrons are produced, there could be something called a chain reaction. He had no idea about fission, that wasn't in the air yet. But he thought that this might be possible, and he applied for a patent, which was granted in 1934 or 35. So let me go through the time sequence again. December 10th, Fermi gets a Nobel Prize. 22nd, Hahn and Strassmann published. Fermi arrives in New York on January 3rd, unaware of this result. January 6th, Meitner and Frisch explain the barium result as fission. Frisch goes back to Copenhagen and tells Niels Bohr, who immediately says, "My God, I should have thought of that." Frisch actually was an experimentalist, and he took out a neutron source, radium-beryllium mixture,
powder that produced neutrons, and looked at radiation coming from uranium when bombarded with neutrons. And he saw the enormously energetic radiation coming out of it, which were the fission fragments. Nobody had looked. In fact, Fermi and company, when they did the original measurement, put absorber foils in between their counters and the uranium foil because they didn't want to be flooded with alpha particles, so they missed any fission fragments. So Bohr knew all about this, but he was on a wave month lecture series in Princeton, and so he knew about it, but didn't intend to spread the news. But there was another physicist on the boat, and he couldn't resist discussing it with him, and they didn't caution him to keep it quiet. Bohr arrives in New York together with the other physicist on the boat, goes to Princeton, and but the other physicists immediately spread the information, so it became known right away. From Princeton, it went, Rabi and Lamb were visiting Princeton the same day. They came back to New York, and one of them told Fermi, it's not clear which one. So Fermi, just about January 18th, Fermi finally informed. You can imagine what he felt like. He just got the Nobel Prize, and it was a mistake. Fascinating. Not that, I mean, Fermi deserved the Nobel Prize many times over. There's no question about that, but that's the way it works. By January 28th, the news had spread all over. There was a small Van de Graaff at the Department of Terrestrial Magnetism in Washington. And this gentleman is Merle Tuve, whom I actually knew at, many years ago. He and collaborators did an experiment to repeat it, and indeed found that with neutrons and uranium, they got huge pulses. Essentially repeated Frisch's measurement a few weeks later. But there was a meeting of theoretical physicists in Washington where Fermi, Bohr, and others were present. And so they invited them over to come in the evening after dinner and see the data actually coming in. So a picture was taken, and here you see Tuve and his collaborator without ties, as working physicists are, and the rest of the people from the conference dressed for dinner at the demonstration of fission. So everybody was convinced. Others also, there's a paper, there's a meeting of the French Academy on January 30th in Joliot, not fully aware of all the things that were published, were out, and concludes that there must be fission. By February, there were four letters to the editor in Physical Review, equivalent of Physical Review letters, among them from Fermi, all confirming fission, and many more around the world. Email wasn't there. Telephones were, transatlantic telephone service was not very reliable. The news traveled by boat, but it worked remarkably fast. And call your attention that 10 days between submission of manuscripts and publication. The refereeing process worked much better than it does today. News spread, and I won't give you too many more, I'll give you some more timelines. By April 29th, the American Physical Society had its spring meeting, which was always in Washington. So there was a meeting in Washington, and at that meeting, fission was discussed, and the New York Times had scientists say a bit of uranium could wreck New York. It's remarkably accurate. Bohr, who is identified as a colleague of Dr. Albert Einstein, just for people to whom Bohr's name didn't mean anything, but Einstein's did, is quoted as saying a small amount of a pure isotope 235 of uranium with slow neutron particles of atoms would start a chain reaction or atomic explosion. And the difficulty of low abundance of the relevant isotope of uranium was identified as a problem. But then Onsager got up and said that, well, you could use gaseous diffusion for isotope separation in quantity. And nuclear explosion would wreck New York City. All these things in the New York Times in April 1939. I was not aware that this was that broadly known. Though I vaguely remember reading something about uranium fission as a boy in a popular science book. Okay, chain reaction. Szilard, of course, was all excited about discovery of fission because he had this patent on chain reaction idea that we could produce things. And here was an example of something that might work, provided there are sufficient neutrons in it. He was in New York by that time and had some sort of a courtesy appointment at Columbia. He got together with Walter Zinn, who was at City College of New York, and they worked together to achieve this. Szilard was one of these people who was extremely brilliant, always full of ideas, but he didn't like to work too hard. So he had to have collaborators. And Walter Zinn, who of course all know, was the first director of Argonne, or second director, if you count Fermi. In the paper that they published in the summer of 1939, they report that neutrons, about 2.3 neutrons, were emitted in each fission of uranium, which is remarkably close of the value that we know now. They also mentioned delayed neutrons, which were known by then. And they had a reasonable measure of a fast neutron cross-section. Szilard was very concerned about the implication of this. I mean, the fact that, as you saw from a New York Times article, it was understood that weapons could be, this had weapons implications. World War II was on the verge of getting started. And Szilard got together with two other Hungarian refugees, Wigner and Teller, and discussed what they should do. And they contacted, I think, Teller, you gentleman by the name of Sachs, who was the advisor to Roosevelt, and they thought they would consult him. And he said, well, take this to the White House. Don't go to the military. They'll get tied up in bureaucracy. So then they approached Albert Einstein to whether he would be willing to put his prestige behind it, because a letter with his name on it would have a much much more weight than anything they did. And actually, Wigner drove out Szilard to Long Island, where Einstein had was vacationing, and here they are, the balcony of a vacation home, and Einstein looking at the draft that Szilard had prepared. The letter was actually delivered by Sachs. Here's a little bit more of the time. Timeline. And I'm sorry, I was looking at the time and it says 57 minutes, but that can't be right. Okay, so papers by Fermi and collaborating with Szilard, which was a fascinating thing because Fermi's idea of doing an experiment was to roll up his sleeves and get to work. Szilard's idea was to go back to his room, take a nap, and think about it. And they somewhat created out each other, but then learned that they could collaborate and stay out of each other's way. So August was a letter to Roosevelt. Sachs actually delivered it in October. As a result, they got a go-ahead, met with the army people and asked how much money they needed to start, and they wanted $6,000 for graphite. The reason for graphite was that moderating neutrons to low energies necessary for fission on U-235. One could use water, but the capture cross-section was known to be high on hydrogen, heavy water, which is difficult to come by, or possibly graphite. But graphite was plagued with impurities. Szilard was actually instrumental in getting very high purity graphite, and the measurement was carried out, and the absorption was found to be very small. There was by then a new National Defense Research Committee established with Vannevar Bush as chair, and they looked at this and said it was a promising energy source, but weapons would take too long, so it was given low priority. But then work at Berkeley by Seaborg and company showed that you could make U-239 from U-238 by neutron bombardment that would decay to plutonium, and that plutonium would have properties very similar to U-235 in large thermal neutron fission cross-sections. And that if one could get a chain reaction, reacting pile going, one could make it in kilogram quantities easily. And that would be a lot easier than separating U-235. Lawrence took this on as a project. Lawrence was a very activist, politically savvy scientist. And went to Vannevar Bush, and he decided to restore priority with a delay of almost a year. By then, the first review article on fission was published by Louis Turner. Turner was, in fact, the division director, physics division director at Argonne at the time I was hired. And here he is presenting Niels Bohr, who was visiting Argonne in about 1958, with something which may well be a piece of CP1 graphite. I remember this visit because Niels Bohr was here. I was a young assistant physicist. Bohr said he wanted to give an informal talk to a few people, and so I was not invited to attend. I was very upset about it. So various piles, subcritical piles, were tested. First one, Columbia. This coefficient K has to be larger than one for chain reaction to sustain itself. K was 0.87. They worked together, but Szilard, Compton was in charge of the project once the priority was established. Compton was at the University of Chicago. He had a bad cold when the meeting of the Uranium Committee was held in Chicago to decide how to proceed. And so they met in his bedroom. Lawrence was, Szilard was, Alvarez was, Lawrence is quoted as saying, "You'll never get it going here. The whole tempo is at the University of Chicago is too slow." But Chicago was picked nevertheless. And Fermi agreed to move from Columbia to Chicago. Moisture was an issue because of the water. So they devised a way of having a balloon pumping on it and removing the moisture.
k equal 0.918 was achieved in the new pile at Columbia about the time Fermi left. But Chicago was also working on it. Sam Allison at the University of Chicago had set up something at Stagg Field and reported k of 0.94. So it was approaching it, and all the parameters looked right for being able to do it. I'm sorry. Could you turn up this microphone, please? But they have another one.
I'm sorry. I thought this microphone was working. Anyway,
one more, a couple of more items here, then we'll go a little bit faster. Roosevelt was worried about the German effort. Nobody knew what was happening in Germany, and so he decided to give this project high priority. Security was a concern, particularly by Gregory Bright, with whom I took a course as a graduate student. He was in charge of the theoretical backup for it with Fermi, but he was very upset at the project and the lack of security. He complained that scientists were too free to discuss anyone else on the project what they were doing, and he believed in something which is probably modern parlance would be need to know. Finally he resigned, and bitterly complaining to Compton about one scientist whom he didn't name, who was particularly bad in this, and actually came to his office when he was not there and looked up some of his notes, Bright's notes. Well, the scientist he complained about was Fermi. So Bright resigns, and he was replaced by Oppenheimer as a theorist initially. By the summer of 1942, Compton, who liked horseback riding with his wife, one of the places they went was one of the forest preserves on the outskirts of Chicago, called the Argonne Forest Preserve, and decided that that would be the site for the first test of chain reaction. But the Army was taking charge of it, and the Corps of Engineers hired a large contracting firm, Stone and Webster in Boston, to do it. And as is the case when too much bureaucracy gets involved, the building was not ready. There was a strike, and the company didn't handle it right, and so on. So Fermi came to Compton and said, well, there's this double squash court under Stagg Field, large enough to do the job, and Compton agreed. But he did not bother to, he decided not to consult with Hutchins. He felt, at least according to his memoirs, that Hutchins would have no choice but to say no, and so he felt he assumed the responsibility, because if it didn't work, he would get blamed anyway. If it worked, nobody would mind. So the project started November 16th, 1942, and lots of timber was bought, because layers of timber and graphite had to be done. Now, these graphite bricks had to be highly polished so they would fit tightly together to minimize the amount of air and moisture that can be trapped. Machinists, physicists, students, members of the football team all worked hard on stacking the carbon, on first polishing the carbon, machining it. It was a very dirty job. People were given masks to wear, but most of them were heavy smokers, and they didn't felt that there's no point in wearing the protective masks with the graphite dust. Balloon to evacuate turned out in the end was not needed. In less than 3 weeks, the pile was complete and ready for testing. Here are some pictures layer by layer. Here's a layer where the holes in the graphite bricks for containing either uranium metal or uranium oxide. They had a collection of uranium samples of as high purity as they could get, and Fermi spent a lot of time deciding how to distribute the various purities of uranium to optimize chances. Then layers of graphite. And this is layer 29. Under construction, you can see the timber walls here that contained it. And you can see the little bit of a balloon that was not used in the end. Now this, I thought at first, this was in the collection of pictures that Argonne Archives has. I assumed that this was completed CP1. But then I looked up how big it was supposed to be. And unless this man was 9 feet tall, it couldn't have been the CP1. I don't know what this was, maybe just a pile of graphite bricks waiting to be stacked. So the actual, this chip, strip chart recorder, I'm sure you have seen before. You can see how control rods are removed and the neutron flux goes up. And here, if scale is changed, it continues to go up, goes up until finally the test is complete, and they went down. Must have been extremely exhilarating to watch that. The artist's conception of the CP1 probably gives a better idea of what the scale was. You can see the pile here of roughly the right height. You can see that the diameter, it was considerably taller than it was at least four people on top of each other. And nice images of Szilard, Fermi, and Wigner. Compton looks a little diabolical, I don't know why. And also, if you look at it carefully, it's clearly an artist's conception, because all these people have white coats on. And as you know, no self-respecting physicist would wear a lab coat unless absolutely essential. Here's a picture which is supposedly from 1946 of some of the participants, and I've labeled some of them. Hilbery and Zinn are the first two, well, if you like, Fermi, Zinn, and Hilbery are the first three directors of Argonne, or the first two, depending on how you want to define it. Wigner was not there. Wattenberg was the first director of Argonne Physics Division. Here's Szilard. He often wore a raincoat. Herb Anderson, I knew as a colleague at Chicago. Sam Allison, you were at Chicago. And Agnew, who later became director of Los Alamos. This is in front of Eckhart Hall, where I remembered teaching courses until the new physics building was done. The site A that I mentioned in Argonne is on the, is 10 minutes away from here. If you have not seen it, you should go there and visit it. There are stones saying, "Do not dig," the world's first nuclear reactor. It's a small park around it. As I say, it's a 10-minute drive. Okay, so a quick talk about aftermath of CP1 and sort of sermon about science. The impact of CP1, the Manhattan Project that it engendered, on society was enormous. I tried to find a picture of a Trinity test that had some people in it, and I found this, advertised as being such, but people who know better tell me that this cannot be the Trinity test. Anyway, this tower is, I think, genuine. And I thought this picture was better than the normal ones of mushroom cones. This happened, of course, in the 1940s. Next decade, we had Sputnik. Decade after that, we had the lunar landing. These events, but particularly the Manhattan Project, had enormous impact on how society viewed science. The demonstration, a dramatic demonstration of basic science, where nuclei were discovered 30 years later, we had CP1. Fission was discovered 3 years later, we had CP1. It was just fantastic. I thought other sciences quickly followed physical sciences. New disciplines became called desmatter physics, astrophysics, whole areas of biology just exploded in, thanks to the increased support of science in the decades that followed. I want to talk only, and I apologize for this, about a few nuclear physics accomplishments. In nuclear physics, the major insight, the framework in which we see nuclear structure was formulated by Maria Mayer, who was here at Argonne at the time. Her view of nucleus showing that it had a model closely related to Bohr's model of the atom is the basis of much of our understanding. She got the Nobel Prize in 68, but while she was working on this work in Shell model, I came across what was the evaluation form then, which was not so different what was used even now. Notice that her supervisor, whoever that was, rated her productivity as just a shade above average. Quality of her work was just a shade above average. Knowledge of her field was better. Anyway, so much for annual evaluations. Sorry, I couldn't resist that. So, a few other major accomplishments of the field. Neutrinos came to be understood much better. The neutrino was first suggested as a more or less a joke in a letter to by Wolfgang Pauli to a meeting of people interested in radioactivity as a possible way to explain beta decay. He never published it beyond this letter. Fermi took it seriously and developed the theory of beta decay, and he certainly deserves a Nobel Prize for that, among other things. It wasn't for another 20 years before neutrinos were actually observed. They were found to oscillate because they have finite mass by Ray Davis in 1980 and further measurements in McDonald. So 5 Nobel Prizes in 100 years for properties of a neutrino. Protons and neutrons have been discovered to have structure. Not quite the same way that we say the nuclei have structure. Nevertheless, we think of them as made up of quarks, except quarks can never be free. They are always confined. It can be deconfined in limited regions of space at very high energy density, and some work has been done on that. A whole picture of substructure of hadrons has changed. But there are some very interesting puzzles. The gluons that are thought to keep quarks together make the protons and neutrons heavier. Quarks are much lower in mass, and unlike nuclei, which get lighter the tighter they are bound, the nucleon's mass is much, much higher than that of the constituent quarks. There are quasi theological inconsistencies in that, though theory is certainly tells us that this is the best understanding we have. Remember, 100 years before, neutrons were not mentioned even in textbooks because they had not been demonstrated to exist. Neutrinos were more or less accepted, but didn't become real until they were actually seen. Quarks, we accept now as the correct explanation in the standard model for hadron structure. Properties of nuclei. The nuclei that are stable are shown in black squares here. The nuclei that we know as radioactive nuclei are the light gray area here. The unexplored, all this area is unexplored. Yet we believe that the way stars work, nucleosynthesis goes along paths through this region. We have major efforts going on exploring what is going on. Gravitational waves have been observed, which depend critically on properties of nuclear matter. And the details of how they are related are there. I'm sorry, I just wanted to mention a few examples, and I talked about nuclear physics. The staggering advances in biological fields on the molecular level, and there have been enormous advances in science. So, conclusions. I believe we are living in a very special epoch of humanity. The last few centuries have enormously enlarged our understanding of nature. All of us who are doing something in research, basic or applied, should feel that very fortunate that we live in this epoch. CP1 represents a major accomplishment, or perhaps the major accomplishment, in the course of human history in applying science to what are the perceived needs of society. We are right to celebrate it. But let me just say a little bit how I see it, how science has helped us to, as an evolutionary tool. How have we done in helping our species' evolutionary success? How has our understanding improved human well-being? Well, one measure is in the population. If you plot global human population from about 10,000 BC on to 2,000 years ago, it has increased from about 5 million to maybe 200 million. Then, until about 1800, it went up to about a billion. Now, it has increased by a huge factor. It looks like we are approaching a singularity, and a singularity is not a good thing. Little more hope if you take the derivative and plot the rate at which this changes, and here I've done it per generation, roughly 25 years, you see the same effect, that we went up in the rate of increase, but then in the last 50 years,
perhaps we have gone down. Now, the expansion in science I've talked about is just in this period. So we have more than done our job in science in allowing humanity to use its skills to expand its numbers and its welfare. No question that humanity is doing better now than it did in the past. But, well, I wanted to show where CP1 fits in that curve. These two jumps, incidentally, are World War I and World War II. Conclusions: science has made enormous advances in Darwinian evolution. CP1 is a crown jewel to this achievement, even though we may have some slight feelings of guilt about how it was motivated. The test is yet to come. Is our species smart enough to have our collective intelligence put limits on this expansion? Use our intelligence for 70 years have managed to overcome the threat of nuclear weapons. So maybe there's hope that we can use our intelligence to do this, make use of achievements and insights of science to control our world. Thank you very much.
Thank you, John. Thank you very much. How about a question or two for John, please?
Clearly, either everything was understood or nothing was understood.
No, got one down here.
So with regard to Fermi's errant Nobel Prize, my understanding of that had always been that even though the awarders had cited the Nobel Prize for the transuranic elements, that in fact the proper context of the understanding is that he had achieved fission, even though he hadn't properly explained it yet. Could you speak to that?
Well, fission was not known at the time the Nobel Prize was awarded. So you're right that it amounted to achieving fission, but the Nobel Committee didn't know that.
Right, but my I guess what I was trying to understand and clarify is that he had in fact caused a fission event.
Yes, yes. No, the activity was he observed was barium, and it was the same activity Hahn and Meitner showed conclusively to be barium, but so he had seen. If you put neutrons on uranium, you get some fission.
So what he was describing as transuranic were in fact fission fragments then?
What he thought was transuranics were fission products. I'm sorry, I should have made that clear.
Another question for John? No? Well, I appreciate all the hard work and certainly the research and the it's very interesting to see the timelines and to pull the story together, John. So thank you very much. Let's give John another round of applause, please.